Right, welcome back to Pub Breakfast. In this hour, we want to take a look at the news that are making headlines and start by looking at what the dailies are saying. But before that, I'd like to introduce the panel that's going to be helping me do this. We'll begin at my far right, Damson Riziki, who is a lawyer and an analyst. We also have Vincent Kimosop, who is a political analyst as well. George Kizzy, who is a lawyer. We're also expecting Joy Medivo, who is a lawyer, will be joining us a little bit later on as well. Gentlemen, welcome. Big day, of course. People looking towards the ruling that's going to be made by the Supreme Court. But also dominating the headlines is the killings that sparked clashes and the tension that is in the city, covered by both dailies. The Daily Nation saying Islam killings spark clashes, tension in the city, and Vincent has one that says war of words as chaos rocks the city. Blame game as well over there. We begin by taking a look at that one, and I guess first of all, just your general comments on the same. Let's start with you, George. I mean, Danston. You don't need to pronounce it very well. Danston.
Okay, one thing about probably the issues of, most importantly about the issues of chaos within the city, I think is a feeling of exclusion and seclusion among us, maybe some city dwellers, more so with the inclusion in government machineries and government functionaries. That exclusion for me is a historical thing. It's not a one-off thing. It's not about the election process. Because if you look at the sessional paper number 10, the sessional paper number of 1965, sessional paper number 14 of 1975, created some areas and we can call them zones, mm-hmm. that were high-end zones. That's people in those zones are better off in terms of economics and all that. Other people from other zones are feeling probably left out. And politics has only become as a window to vent out their anger through what they call seclusion. And the other thing is about the belief in electoral justice system. The belief in the electoral justice system has been time, no numbers been bashed, and people don't believe so much in the process. That's in this moment in time, I think also the politicians are taking advantage of the situation in that they can take that to incite their supporters. I think another thing about maybe the city, the clashes within the city, is the aspect of unemployment. Mm-hmm. And I think the best way to tackle some of these issues is actually entrenching devolution, because some of these people, were in their counties, their mother counties, there will not be so much the violence within the city. Mm-hmm. And solving that moving forward, first of all, a clear electoral justice system, entrenching the devolution, making sure that they work at the county level, and creating opportunities for everybody. Mm-hmm. That will cure the unemployment and the chaos more so. And also on the part of the politicians, let them exercise some decorum in terms of how they articulate their issues, how they articulate their grievances, more so among us, their supporters. That will bring some level of level-headedness among us, various individuals within the electoral cycle and the electoral system, mm-hmm. and the body politic at large.
Right, let's take one word you said there, which is to cure, and just some of the things you mentioned as well, and I'll ask Vincent also to weigh in on this. The seclusion aspect, one would think that it would be remedied by, devolution. Mm. And then, and yet we still find that people are still talking about we've been locked out, tumelemewa, tumefungiwa. Mm. And of course, we're going to talk about the political arm in it, what the politician should do. But what do you think about what Danson has mentioned as well?
I agree to just to add what he said, is that we are also reaping from the benefits of the troubles that come with politics of hate,
right?
Politics that is canvassed on a platform of ethnic identity. Are we also reaping from the impact of having a huge population that is unemployed, particularly the youth? Mm-hmm. What I would summarize, Willis, is that we are where we are today because of the unfinished business of the Grand Coalition government, specifically on agenda item number 4. What we did with the agenda item number 4 is that we only were able to deal with one thing, the whole issue of having a new constitution. But you can imagine The good book talks about having old wine in new, as in having old wine in new wineskins. Eh? So here I'm referring to the institutions that mediate, the institutions that facilitate the implementation of that constitution. So in my view, we have to address the issue of youth unemployment. We have to address the issue of reforming our institutions, like as you see in the constitution is a letter. The spirit of it, like now the shift from having a police force to a police service is moving from the text to the spirit of the constitution. The other thing that you also see is it's very clear that when you look at the chapter on the executive, specifically the chapter on the cabinet, if you go across the country, and I've done this with some engaging the church leaders like NCCK, is that communities in Kenya want to be in government. Now, the same communities want to elect one of their own to be in that government. From an election, you know very well, there will be winners and losers. One of the things that our constitutions that need to be addressed is the whole issue of winner wins it all and a loser loses it all. And that is what happens in a spoiled system, in the sense of a presidential system. So, and then also the framework for the alternative government here, looking at opposition to prosecute the agenda, is not very clear under the current constitutional framework. So you have a situation, and I think I'd say that since we're in the media, when you even read the scripts, the somebody like we have a president in terms of Uhuru Kenyatta, and then we have an opposition. But when you ask yourself, who is the leader of opposition? Constitutionally, it is the leader of minority, both in the Senate and in the National Assembly. But in the media, the leader of opposition is the NASA presidential candidate. So there are things that we need to now go back and say, hey, how do we ensure that we have a society that facilitates everybody so that they can prosecute their agenda? Mm-hmm. And that's why it is important to have an audit of this constitution and possibly tweak things that are not working.
Mm-hmm. John?
Yes, pick from what my colleagues have said, but I want to add a twist to it in this sense. You see, probably by way of example, when we were interacting with the community on the elections 8th of August, our proceeding to that, of course, was the campaign period. Now, when you go to campaign, you meet this old lady who has not eaten for 2-3 days, or 1 meal in 2-3 days. What is the narrative to that person? Is it a calendar? Is it a campaign t-shirt? Is it a flyer? Or is it food? Now, how do you then organize those that have that problem, mm-hmm. meaning the poor? One, for sustainability, but for political agenda. And therefore, if you look at the relationship between the have and the have-nots in Nairobi, you begin to understand why this political tension is an identity in the slums and the poor the poor living areas in the city. People in Karen, people in Lavington will never be organized in the manner that the people of Abadogo and others are organized. Mm. Because the social system and structure is different. One is that people must have a lot to lose in the event that the social order is distorted and disrupted. They have something to lose. If you have nothing to lose, then you have a lot to gain when you are incited to loot, because the opportunity to get is available. And therefore, one of us here, it would be very interesting to see you breaking into a shop and walking out with a mobile phone, because it has never been a need. You've always had an opportunity to have your own, and the opportunity to get it is available anyway. Mm-hmm. But for those that the opportunity to have is not immediate, and therefore a demonstration is an opportunity either to be funded, or if you're not funded, then within the process of demonstration, it's highly likely you're coming back home with bananas. And that's an opportunistic approach to what life is. In the whole system, as things are unraveling, it is all about self-preservation. Mm-hmm. Yes, the sum total of it is there's a leader that you subscribe to, but ultimately when you get home, you must eat. And then
The social circumstances begin with the hunger and the have-nots. It then coalesces into who are we, and the identity issue with them is ethnocized. And you realize that people group themselves into the ethnic belongings, sometimes even clan belongings. Mm-hmm. Like he said, at the village, you have a house that if burned, then you lose it. So then you can't behave the same way you behave when you're in Mathare. The reason is, in Mathare, you have nothing to lose. But back home, you have a lot to lose because the chicken, if killed, you mourn it. Then it's because you have, when you come to the city, you look at yourself like a stranger. We have not socialized our system such that where you live, you belong there. You come, you look for wealth, and go back home. And invest it back home. Apparently, the mindset being then that is home, and that's where I belong. After retirement, after you leave Nairobi, you go back home to the village. Mm-hmm. The reason for that is because that's where apparently you've invested after socializing in the city. Mm-hmm. So that the city doesn't then give an opportunity for a social system of belonging. The investments we have in Karen are for people who belong to Nairobi. Either way, after retirement, the platform and environment that they live is very different. So what happens then when we are ethnocized? Put it this way. After every cycle of election, now, before, and many times to come, if then we remain a democratic society with the system that we have, we must divide ourselves. How is that? It's because for an election to happen, people must compete. For an election to happen, people must vote. For an election to happen, we must divide ourselves alongside biases, which completely uncontrolled by logic, by law, by the constitution. So then if I have to vote for you because you're my friend, because you're from my tribe, mm-hmm. it's available as a right to myself. Mm-hmm. Which means this, that then eventually what is immediately available as the fourth line for division is ethnicity. Because we don't have any other. Assuming we are a literate society, then it is about the ideology like they have in the US. What do you subscribe to as an ideology? Mm-hmm. Today, the political parties themselves cannot sustain an ideology because the clientele base with which whom they rule have nowhere we thought to plant that seed of ideology, mm-hmm. for the reason that they are poor and they look at what then is immediate to divide themselves. So the fault lines in our politics shall right. remain to be ethnicity. Right. If I'm right about that, then whichever way we handle our politics, it will be ethnocized. If then I'm right about that, we cannot help the fact that at every election and at every dispute, ethnicity is what will rule. Mm-hmm. Suffice it to say, therefore, right. that unless we treat, like he said, the very basis of formation of the society, fighting poverty and illiteracy, which is basically the cardinal aspect upon which our society as Kenya was made up. We knew that when we fight ethnicity and we fight poverty and we fight the other ills that first our society, then like illiteracy, then some of these things resolve themselves. If we don't do that like we failed to do today, cross-sectionally, then we will have the same problems we had in the 60s. Mm-hmm.
And of course, going back to you, Dustin, then you pointed out some fashion of purpose, and like George, you said, we need to go back to the roots. But also, what is causing this, like George says, you're very ethnocized, is people would say is the politicians themselves, and the picture that George has said is that it is because of the response of the clientele, which is the voter. But they definitely have a role to play. Like in this scenario, Vincent has said, we don't call him opposition leader, the national leader, Raila Odinga, is blaming the state. The deputy president saying, you know, the police should rein in on violence. Police saying that the killings were not based on sort of ethnic cleansing. And just also by way of information, they were actually invited yesterday by Hussein Mohammed to come by the, of course, they didn't send in a representative, but we still have the statement by Jafet Kone saying that, you know, it is not ethnic based. So what role do politicians have in, like, what we are seeing?
Actually, you see, when I want to look at the Kenyan scenario, I'll compare it two scenarios. One is the aspect of civil disobedience. And this aspect of civil disobedience is one of the ingredients that many countries are going through a revolution strike to employ. If you look at the Orange Ukrainian Revolution in the Orange Revolution in Ukraine, if you look at the Rose Revolution in Georgia, those are the issues. Those are the kind of issues they try to put in place. One of the aspects or one of the ingredients of a good revolution is disobedience, and that aspect of disobedience. At the time we had Raila arrive at the airport, there was an aspect of order from the airport up to a particular stage, probably the areas where there is maybe business activities. At that moment in time, I think probably the manner in which the opposition leaders or the NASA brigade tried to manage their supporters was not in line with what the expectation of the police was, and it's not possible within the sub-Saharan Africa, where poverty and other ills, as pointed out by Kithi, have influenced our society. That creates a permeation of gangs and maybe vagabonds to come in and join the procession and the demonstration. When that is done, that is not within the premeditation of the Public Order Act, also Article Section 8 and 9 and 10, where you are required, if you are organizing a procession for that matter, you are required to provide enough security and also control them through the entire procession. When that happens, this, in the mindset of the supposed maybe thugs or vagabonds within the procession, they take that advantage. And what is it that probably as a nation, what causes this? One, for me, I cannot even blame anybody who goes out. You can blame thereafter. But the reason, some of the reasons that makes him or her to go out and probably steal, you get somebody, so in a photo of, a person has stolen bananas holding a knife. You get, what really motivates this person to steal a bunch of bananas holding a knife? You know, does it make sense? One of the reasons why, what makes that person to do that, is because he feels as a person he has not been enabled by the state or by the government, or there is no a conducive environment for him to be able to also acquire that through legal means. That is one. So if as a country we want to move forth, first of all we should see and ask ourselves what is causing this to happen. Look, I'll give you an example. I come from Busia County, and within Busia County we don't have an industry for example that can take care of these the young graduates or maybe mid-level graduates to be employed or absorbed in those industries. When these people are not absorbed, one of their only hope is to come to Nairobi. Mm-hmm. When they come to Nairobi, it's not going to get any gainful or meaningful employment for that matter, because maybe it's not so much trained. But for example, if our counties were enabled in a way that one way the political leadership within the county level is in a position to create enough job opportunities at the county level, mm-hmm. so that we can be able to absorb some of our youth who are graduating or who are leaving school. I'll give an example again. Near Nairobi, we have Murang'a County. Murang'a County has a very simple project called the One Car, One Home Project. One Car, One Home Project, it might look so simple, but if you can imagine, if one cow is in every home, what the outcome of it is that every cow, every home has milk. Then the excess of this milk is sold to Brookside or New KCC. By that, you reduce unemployment. When you reduce unemployment, nobody feels secluded. Nobody feels left out within the government structures. And that is what I think this country needs to do. To our politicians, what's more cardinal in terms of solving this continued feeling of seclusion or not being included in governance structures? One is to do away with this presidential system. The pure presidential system is a creature that now creates animosity. When, as Kimosop has pointed out, when, for example, Raila, you know, within the constitution, is premeditated that the winner of the election shall have 50 plus 1. Mm-hmm. So the loser for that election has 49 minus 1. If that is the example, this person has a magnificent or humongous following within the country. Mm-hmm. If we have to move forth as a country, this person who has lost should be enabled to feel also important, and he don't just feel important or for example for the purpose of it, but he also has ideas that he needs to cascade through the government structures. If he has to do, the best way to do that is to have him either in the National Assembly or in the Senate. For me, I would suggest probably such a person should be in the Senate, so that he can be able to maybe maneuver or legislate or make his contribution through a requisite procedure, rather than what we're having at the moment, where a loser, he's outside there, but then he tries to have some influence or legislative influence for that matter, making his input towards the governance structures very minimal. If you are able to have such kind of people through the structures, then you'll never see at any moment in time when somebody loses the presidential election, nobody will feel left out. But at any given moment in time, if somebody loses, it will be a disaster. Then lastly, mm-hmm. if you're looking at the counties, I'm trying to think loud. After this election, the next election, 2022, it might be worse. Worse in the sense that, I'm looking at these young governors, for example, Kingi, for example, Mandago or whoever, at maybe the age of 50 or 55 years, you are told at this moment in time, you have served as two terms as a governor, then you don't need to serve any other term. What if, where will these young governors, in our case, where will they go to? Are we going to go to Nigerian way? You know, in Nigeria, there's a state called the Biafra. In Biafra, the guys, the leaders of that area, because of the constitutional requirements, once they were not able to go for the second term, after the conclusion of their second term, they literally came together and formed now, can I say, a warlord group. Yeah. And this is my little fear, both as a lawyer and as a politician, as a political analyst. I'm looking at it, what will be the outcome of next 2022 election, mm-hmm. in regards that if these leaders are not harnessed well, then we're going to experience, you see, now we're only dealing with the top, but that 2022 will be dealing with the second tier, mm-hmm. where we have governors who have served for two terms and they cannot seek maybe that gubernatorial position. Assuming they also don't want to seek that maybe a senatorial position, I believe maybe most of them will not likely want to seek maybe a member of parliament position. It will, this card of politicians might be worse off and might create another fiefdom,
right.
that will now create real havoc in this country. And I think as a people, we should revolve our discourse around the issues of what next for this young kind of leaders.
I think, my brother, just to say this, I pick the symptoms that we should not want to build on a point. How do we learn from other countries? The Biafra example. I think it will be tragic for us when we legislate with individuals in mind. We should legislate with principles and ideas in mind. I can tell you, one of the, and I repeat, the agenda, when we had a problem in 2007, 2008, we summarized them into the four agendas. Cessation of violence, number two, restoration of humanitarian support, and then number three was the political question that had to take Kofi Annan, Raila and Kibaki to sit to resolve. The guys in Serena could not. And then the fourth was what was really about the public, which is national cohesion, unemployment, dealing with historical injustices. For me, my colleagues, I think we should not legislate again with people in mind. Remember the guys who legislated in parliament, they passed a constitution, but they did not want to empower the Senate. Some of them left the National Assembly, and when they went to the Senate, they realized that actually things are not what we wanted. So what, in my summary, that we should do, I think we need to expand the executive. Mm-hmm. One thing that has come out very clearly is that as communities are interested in being represented in the national executive, could we revisit maybe the lessons from the harmonized constitution, Bomas draft, on how do we have a broader executive? Mm-hmm. Then number two is that we need to dignify the opposition. I think if we dignify the opposition by addressing that issue, that if you have like 40%, you look at this, you get 6 million votes, a governor gets maybe 300 votes, they control a budget, they have a cabinet, and you have an opposition that, hey, they go home out of it. So in my view, that way, so that irrespective of who will be number two, next time it might be another person, is you mentioned former governors, that that critical constituency is still engaged in the policy discourse in the country. You see, that way you are strengthening the system. The reason why we 2013 and 2017 elections was different from 2007 is because we had the Supreme Court. So today we are waiting for the judgment of the Supreme Court, and everybody, if we strengthen our institutions so that our issues are mediated by those institutions rather than individuals, then we are moving in the right direction. That's why even as there are calls today, Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila should meet. In my view, it is okay for them to meet, but that discussion or that dialogue should not be about just addressing the interests on the political extent. It should also be, how do we ensure that it is broad-based? How do we ensure that out of that discussion, the youth unemployment, the issues of inclusion, the issues of national cohesion are addressed? Because today, courtesy of the disruption that we have, you have people in the tourism sector who do not have a direct impact on the elections. They are missing out. Revenues, even in terms of collections, when you look at also the level of economic activity, it's gone down. Right. So that everybody is moved forward, not just the political class. And then finally, I think we need to reduce the dividends that the political class have in our country. There has been a lot of focus on the politician. Society is not just about politics. We have other actors in the society. So in my view, those are some of the things on how we can move this conversation forward.
And judging as I come to you as well, there are different things that have been mentioned there, and I'll speak out a few of them. Do you think that the leaders themselves are doing enough? Like Vincent has said, I mean, there have been many calls, the NASA leader and the President Kenyatta should sit, but then they meet at funerals and everything, and then once that is done, they go back and they take on the podiums and they do what they do best. Are they doing enough, or are they the ones more fanning to the, what you call it, the clientele, which is the electorate?
Well, let me just repackage my narrative this way, that you see, if you walk home, right, and you see a cat which is very annoying to you and it's in your bedroom, and you close the windows and you close the door and you want to kill it, you see, what the cat will do is will look for an opening. If it doesn't get the opening, it'll come for you. Now, it may be a small animal, but it's going to be a very, very big struggle for you to even kill it. You may not even manage to kill it. And by the way, you may go out with scratches and end up in hospital or even injure yourself. The point is, you can't cage youth. You can't cage an opponent, because the opponent, the intensity at which the opponent fights back in that action and reaction relationship that you develop is not going to even work to your benefit. The way we fashioned out our constitution was partly on past experiences, some mischiefs we wanted probably to cure. But then we also were reactionary to certain personalities. We didn't have an opportunity to build on the Prime Minister's position. But yet, we were enjoying the environment to discourse on a constitution, basically because a Prime Minister position exists. I mean, we had just come from some political or post-election violence of sorts. And then we said, look, let's share position as the executive and create the Prime Minister position. But then we thought that that's a one-off. You see, 207, 208 has come, it's gone. And we are moving on, not knowing that the society remains the same, and the disputes, the ethnic environment and everything has remained the same, notwithstanding that we have a document called the new constitution. Now fast forward to where we are today. We are where we are because we didn't take care of the interests of the opposition. Now, why I brought the cat story is because the most dangerous person on earth is a neighbor who has nothing to lose. It can't be that you are neighbors, but you have everything. You have the cars, you have the food, you have the employment. I mean, you live in dignity. And the neighbor next to you won't have food. That's why in the Bible, there's the story of the Zacchaeus story of a person who eats from the rich man next door and doesn't go to heaven. Basically, it then talks of the social systems. You know, the neighbor must steal from you, and he steals out of necessity because he must eat anyway. That's why we must fashion out a political settlement out of a constitution, so that then the person who loses doesn't lose everything, because then he steals from you. Meaning that he has to fight back because he has nothing to lose. Mm-hmm. But if after the election you lose power, and if you do not join the political system that has been fashioned out of the constitutional dispensation, then yes, you lose. So you must give an opposition mm-hmm. something to lose. So then they have something to fall back to. And remember, after every election, you don't just deal with people who have lost. You deal with an emotionalized 6.5 million people. That's a big group which can stage discontent in the society. So as a president myself, I would want to develop, to leave a legacy of a unified society. And remember, when you are president, whether you like it or not, you must unify even those that reject you. So then they must be available to be unified. They can't be that if you approach them, they run away from you, hurl stones at you, hurl insults at you for 5 years. It is an impossibility. So for you to socialize the people, other presidents, so to bring them together, there must be a tool upon which you bring them together, meaning a political settlement. Mm-hmm. So then the system must be such as is created. So then apart from the fact that you've taken it, the people are able to be brought close to you through the political system, meaning that which they subscribe to, which is the leadership in the opposition, must be available in that political system, must be socialized, so that then you can sit together and work together. Mm-hmm. The executive must be reformed.
You see the mistake that we did in 2010 is that we approved this constitution. In my view, it was an emotional move. Looks like we wanted to control the former president, maybe Moi or Kenyatta, and yet he had left in 2002 and Kenyatta in 78. So from 1992 all the way to 2007, we had a position of leader of official opposition, well facilitated and actually accessing the policy process. I think that is something we need to restore back. Number two is that we also, I think it was, we should have built on the foundation of the Grand Coalition government, position of the Prime Minister. But now, not as from, you remember the 2007, it was a Grand Coalition government. Here you're looking at appointed from the part of the winning team. So if President Uhuru Kenyatta's win today is reaffirmed, then his part, the Jubilee part. Because you have a country whereby 75% of the population come from 5 tribes, and politics is canvassed on a tribal perspective. So what do you do? Don't run away. Create platforms to allow those communities to be represented in those positions. And that is, because you see, before we started this conversation, I think it is you, Kathy, who told me that politics and logic at times don't go together. Mm. So in a politicized society that you're in, you have to be ready to say it might not work, but it will move the country forward. So in my view, as I say, broaden the executive. Number two, dignify the opposition. But that is on the political platform. Then now, endeavor for the next 5 or 6 years moving ahead to address the real issues. Mm-hmm. When you have young people, look, the political parties call a rally on Thursday, and the stadium is full. I mean, just imagine that. And you know, in the West, you have political rallies even happening at night, so that people can walk during the day, then attend your rallies in the evening. Here you have a rally on Wednesday and the stadiums are full. Of course it is good if I am the one convening, I'm able to persuade and pursue my agenda. But if we step aside and we say, what makes a people, young people, to be available on a weekday to attend a political rally? It's because they are not economically engaged. Then finally, I think we have to strengthen devolution. What do I mean here by strengthening devolution is even we are to give more money to the counties, we also have to strengthen their accountability mechanism, because the amount of waste and the reports that are coming from counties at times discourages one from seeing that is there any hope for opposition, sorry, for devolution. So we have to see how to strengthen accountability, maybe mirror the accountability structures we are talking about at the national level at the county level, so that we have service delivery. Mm-hmm. If you look at the Article 43 of the Constitution, issues to do with education, health, you also look at, as in, those are really the issues that our country needs to focus on.
Right, of course, we want to take a short break, and of course, we'll come back with Dunstan also, because what you said are all very valid points, but of course, most people are asking, like, what do we do now, where we are facing a Supreme Court ruling today, where, you know, people today woke up saying, depending on the ruling, we have to plan our routes, we have to see if we're going to the office. Although, as you quite correctly pointed out, some people are not even employed to begin with. But we'll take a look at some of the scenarios or case studies.